الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم التنزيل بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وقصد في مشيك واغضض من صوتك إن أنكر الأصوات لصوت الحمير. صدق الله العظيم. All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He shower His choicest of peace and blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, His family, His companions, and upon all those who tread His path in the day of Qiyamah. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to mentioning the creation of man, He says, خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Man has been created weak. If we look at our origin, there was a time that we didn't have a name. هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُمْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. There was a time for man, he didn't have a name. He was not even called as something. That was once upon a time in all of our cases. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Man has been created weak. And this weak man has been created with certain inherent instincts in him, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in him as a test. There are certain qualities which are installed in us, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put it into us as a test. For example, anger. Anger is something which is there in all individuals. If a person doesn't have anger, there's something wrong. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam too had that anger. He exposed it at certain times. When there was disobedience to Allah, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam expressed that anger. He exposed it. But just because we have that inherent quality in us, it doesn't justify for an individual to say, you know, if I lose my temper, I break things. If I lose my temper, I'm going to beat someone. Just because that nature is there in a human, he cannot justify his behavior. So what we need to do is, we need to learn how to control that anger. And there are so many other qualities such as anger. We have pride. Just because somebody has pride doesn't mean that he can show off. Quran and Hadith says, no, you have to control that. You have to suppress anger, you have to control your pride. You cannot be proud, you have to humble yourself. Then you are rewarded for that. وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ أَكْثَرَ شَيْءٍ جَدَلًا. We would have recited Surah Al-Kahf today. We would have come across this ayah today. What does it mean? وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ أَكْثَرَ شَيْءٍ جَدَلًا. Most insan, his quality is to be argumentative. He's good at disputing. That's his nature. But does it justify a person to be quarrelsome just because he has this quality? No. So, respected brothers and elders in Islam, there are so many different sifat like this. Anger, pride, being argumentative, the desires. If a person wants to fulfill his desires, he has the lawful ways and he has the unlawful ways. And nobody can justify fulfilling his desires in a haram way, saying that Allah created it for me, that's why I did it this way. No, we are going to say we have to find the right channel. We have to find the halal source. Then you are rewarded for that. So therefore, respected brothers, in this khutbah, inshaAllah ta'ala, we are going to discuss about how disputes affect a marriage and how partners can control themselves in arguments or disputes. So when we look at the couples, we can call it more than 80% or sometimes more than 90% of the couples who come for, you know, marital counseling. We see most of them, or 90% of them, have this problem. It emerged from a dispute. It started off from a dispute. The eruption of the volcano was due to a dispute. And finally it has come many years later, few months later, few weeks later, few days later, where the couple says, we want to end this marriage. But most of the time it started off when each partner or both partners misuse the part of the body which has no bones. That is the tongue. So inshallah ta'ala, let me be discussing about certain points on how to deal with these disputes. So when we look at a person apparently, when we interact with him, we cannot come to a conclusion that this particular person is a good man. He's an argumentative person, he's a disputive person. We cannot come to that conclusion by just merely moving with him for some time. Because this sifa, this quality is exposed by, in fact, all of us when we are at home. Because that is the maidan, the ground, where it is comfortable for us to do that. Because if we are the head of the family, there isn't anybody to question us. So if he's the father of the family, he's the head. So he has his wife, he has his children. So he's the head of the house. So if he misuses his tongue, there isn't anybody to point fingers at him. Because he's the father, so nobody can speak. He's the husband, she cannot speak. So he thinks he's the man. But when he comes out of the house, he's an innocent person. And he comes out as he might look like a cat sometimes, very innocent. But when he goes home, he's like a lion. He roars. He barks like some animal. But when he's outside, he's a very innocent man. So people judge based on how he interacts with the society, forgetting what happens at home. So how to deal with this weakness in us? Which the way we expose anger or the way we dispute with our partners in our marriage. Number one is, respected brothers, we have to remember this quality is something to do with our ego. There are many qualities, but I have mentioned most of it are linked to a person's ego. It's going to be there always with us. Like somebody had a cat. So he went to an elderly man and he asked him, can you name the cat? And he said, you know, you name him Ego. And after some time, the cat grew and it started to cause a lot of trouble at home. So the young boy thought, you know, I have to stop having this cat as a pet because a lot of problem at home, it's breaking things and messing around. So he went to the same elderly man and he told him, you know, how can I get rid of this cat? And the man said, you go to this particular place, go to the junction and you can leave it there and it will find its way. And the boy did as he was asked to, but when he comes home, the cat is there. So he goes back to the elderly man again and he says, no, the cat is back home. He said, no, you go to another city and drop the cat there, then it will not come back. And the boy went traveling for some kilometers and he dropped the cat. When he came back home, he saw the cat again. He goes to the elderly man for the third time and he said, you know, I have done my level best, but I don't know how to get rid of this cat. He said, right, you go to a thick forest where no man has gone. And you go there and you can leave it. And then you can get rid of the cat. He did it as he was instructed. He goes to a forest, a thick forest. And he goes, he opens the bag, the cat jumps out of the bag. And he wants to return home. And he thought to himself, he has lost his way. The cat speaks to him, saying, if you don't know the way, you can follow me. Because cat knew the way back home. So what they deduce from this story is, wherever we go, ego follows us. We need to learn how to control it. So respected brothers, when it comes to an argument, it is our ego which is playing the vital role, because the ulterior motive behind an argument is, I am the winner, you are the loser. And all of us need to bear it in mind, when it comes to a marriage, it is not a World Cup final. It is not a knockout final, where, you know, it's not a knockout tournament, where one party loses and the other party wins. There isn't anything called win and lose in a marriage. There isn't anything called, I have proven it to you. I have proved it. These are the proofs for what you have done. No, that's not marriage. Maybe the marriage might continue, but the happiness in the marriage won't be there for long. So point number one is, the couple has to be committed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before they commit to each other. If they commit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his obedience, giving up sin, doing the good, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring happiness. So that is the root for happiness in a marriage. Number two, the couple shouldn't get angry, they shouldn't lose their temper at the same time. This point number two. This is with regard to anger. Because as I already told, the root cause for all disputes is anger, and that anger is related to our ego. Sometimes we tend to justify our anger. In our community, sometimes we come across people who will say, if the husband breaks the glass, they justify that. They say, he's a man, that's why he broke the glass. But if a woman does the same, they will say, how come she can break a glass, she's a woman. Because we are looking at the same quality in both. I'm not justifying anybody's action there. What I'm trying to say is, whether anybody who breaks the glass, they are at fault. That's not the way to expose anger. But why are we taking one stand when it comes to a man and another stand when it comes to a woman? In Islam, what Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us is, the powerful one, the strong one, is not the one who overpowers the other, but the one who controls himself at the time of anger is the strongest one. Whether it's male or female, there is no difference. But we take a different stand. We justify a man's anger. He screamed at her because he's a man. It's natural that he's going to lose his temper. No, that's wrong according to Islam. That's culture. That's what we have understood. But we cannot bring that into Islam. A similar example, when most of us sometimes tend to feel shy to cry in an audience. We have that feeling inside. If I cry in this gathering, the person next to me might look at me in a different way. That's what's going to happen. Most of us will look at the person next to us. Why is he crying? Sometimes even when we have our sons, when our sons start to cry, we say, no, don't cry, you're a boy. Say, don't cry, you're a boy. What does it mean? Only girls cry. But according to Islam, men cry, women cry. Crying is the sifat of the salihun. So we have put a stop to that cry because of our certain norms in society. But anyways, we cannot justify the anger, whether it's the husbands or the wives. And remember, the moment we lose our temper in a conversation or in an argument, the third person coming in is shaitan. He comes in, but we don't see him, he comes in, because that is the happiest moment for him. In Sahih Muslim, the riwayat comes, shaitan is happy to see when couples separate. When there's a divorce which takes place, shaitan is happy. Because what is going to come after the divorce, most of the time, is what shaitan likes to see. Children are left fatherless. The children have no proper guide. So they don't have proper guidance in their life. They find the wrong path. They become drug addicts. They become the bad apples in the society. They become the outcasts. The people don't look up to them. And shaitan has achieved his goal by separating a couple. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, we need to learn the art of diffusing the situation, not infusing it. You know, there are two words in English, diffuse and infuse. When we look at Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life, we see he was very good at diffusing the situation than infusing it. We don't come across a situation where he infused the situation. But we say we are the head of the family, we feed the family, we have the responsibility of providing, we take so many responsibilities. But when it comes to diffusing the situation at home, few men are able to do it. As we can see, if Prophet was able to do it, we need to remember, infusing can be done by any individual to make the situation worse. To aggravate the situation can be done by anyone. But to diffuse the situation can be done only by wise men. Can only be done by wise women. Not by all individuals. Because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was top in the list. All of us know the incident mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, where a plate of food comes and a wife of the Prophet, from one of his wives, and there was a co-wife with him, and the moment she saw the bowl with food, she comes forward and she breaks it. And one narration mentions, in a narration it comes, there was a ghulam, there was a servant watching all this happen in the household of the Prophet. So the servant brought the plate and she saw the behavior of one of the Ummahatul Mu'mineen. And now here the husband is there And now he needs to diffuse the situation. Number one, he needs to protect the irb, the respect, the honor of the wife who broke the plate. And he also needs to make sure his other wife is not offended. Tough situation. He needs to do all these three things. But look at the way Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam handled it. And look at the words he chose at that situation. That's what I want to highlight. He used the word, the moment the plate broke, he gathered the plate, he put the food, and he asked his wife to have it, and he shared it with others, those who were around. But this servant was there. Now, if Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was silent at that moment, the servant can go out and say that, you know, the behavior of this Ummahatul Mu'minin, one of them was not right. But the words Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used was, "Gharat ummukum." If you are familiar with Arabic, there is a difference between the word ghadibat and gharat. Now generally, if we come across a situation as such, if our partner was to behave in that way in front of others, we are going to use a word saying, she has lost her anger, she has lost her temper, she has become angry. The Arabic word for anger is ghadiba. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't use the word ghadiba for his spouse. He said gharat, which means it's natural for co-wives to have jealousy. And he used that word, no, she has become jealous about the plate of food which has come. He didn't use the word she has got angry. She has become jealous for what happened now. And he smiled, in riwayat it comes, he smiled and he said these words. Now, going back to the servant, even if the servant has to go out, that ghulam, that servant is going to tell the people, you know, this wife of the Prophet, she became jealous, not she became angry. You see the selection of words of the Prophet in a time when a husband finds it difficult to diffuse the situation is an exemplary example where we can see. There are so many examples in Prophet's life. Just one to highlight. So respected brothers, let us learn how to diffuse. Sometimes the selection of words can make things worse. Selection of words. Most of us are comfortable using the WHY. Why did you do that? Why didn't you do that? But we learn the WHY is it's a close-ended question. So if we have to ask our little one at home, why didn't you go to school today? Immediately, or most of the time, the child is going to take the defensive side when it comes to answering that question. And if somebody asks us, why didn't you report to office early? We tend to take the defensive at once. But if we have to change that same question to what made you come late, the answer is going to be different. Because we know the person who questioned us is ready to listen to us so we can clarify things. So most of the time in arguments, men, sometimes women as well, we are very good at using the WHY without our knowledge, not intentionally. But let us, because WHY can infuse the situation, not diffuse it, sometimes. Number three, let it be the other person who wins the argument. Oh, this is something to do with ego. No, I'm not saying the partner has to say, I lost, you won. No, it's not that. Maybe in a lighter note, it can happen within couples. It happens. But when it is a serious situation, I think silence is better. As somebody said, if speaking is silver, silence is gold. If speaking is silver, silence is gold. So, let the other person win the argument. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Ana za'imun bi baytin fi rabdil jannah liman taraka al mira'a wa in kana muhiqqa." He said, "I will assure a house in the center of Jannah for the one who leaves argument even though he is right." Even though he is right. Now, when you look at our lives, when we argue with the same gender, maybe with our co-worker in office, with our friend, we tend to accept that we have lost the argument sometimes. we will not try to prove it, okay, beyond a certain point we'll accept, okay, right, what he's saying is right, and we continue the discussion. But when it comes with our children and with our spouse, it's a very difficult, it's a bitter pill to swallow. That is why he doesn't do it at home. He doesn't do that at home. He does it outside the house. So if we can accept right with, from the heart, I want the house in Jannah for this. I just don't talk about it. We get a house and our marriage survives. Number four. If you have to criticize, do it lovingly with dignity. Al-mu'minu mir'atul mu'min. If you want to criticize, you want to help her reform, then do it with care, with love. Our son, our daughter, due to their small age, they might do something mischievous. They might break the neighbor's window. But how do we approach the son? Son, how many times have I told you not to do this? Please, don't put Dada in this situation again. Next time he breaks it again we will approach in a very light, because we know that child is still small. He doesn't know the value of money. He doesn't know the challenges they are going to face with neighbors. So we go to that level and we speak to the child. But when it comes to our spouse, we find it difficult to criticize certain things what they do with love and care. Like an alim said, when you get married, remember you have got married to a child. Your wife is your first child, and the child to come through the marriage is the second. So when it comes to dealing with your spouse, deal in such a way the way you deal with your child. With love, with care, with dignity, with honor, with respect. And number five, never bring up the mistakes of the past. Never bring the mistakes of the past. Reminding. You know, do you remember you did this? And then you say, you know, I forgive you. Sometimes we are good at saying, I forgive you, but. The word but there is a clear indication that we have not forgiven them 100%. The word but. And this word but comes because of the ego inside. I'm the husband. I can dictate terms to you. I say, but. Don't do this again. I forgive you, but you remember you did this the other day? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Man satara Musliman satarahullah. The one who conceals the shortcomings of a Muslim, Allah will cover the shortcomings of that individual in this world and in the hereafter. Number six, never sleep with an argument unsettled. Never go to bed with an argument which is not settled. Sit, speak, talk about it, discuss, forgive, and that's the end. Because next day in the morning we are going to see the same individual. If we don't settle the argument the night before, the morning is going to become worse, because next day the tea is going to come in that person's hand. We were not going to have a smile in the face, and we are going to start the day and the entire day is ruined. But if you have forgiven the previous night, the morning will be a smile and the day is delightful. Some simple things which we can do to make our lives better. And finally, be the first to apologize. Kullu bani Adam khatta'un. Adam's son is inevitable, he is inherent to error, he errs. But the best ones are those who seek for forgiveness. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the opportunity to practice this. And finally, with a quote, somebody said, a moment of patience in the moment of anger saves you 100 moments of regret. A moment of patience in the moment of anger saves you 100 moments of regret. Many couples argued, they ended up divorcing, and now they regret, why did they go to that? So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen our marriages, grant the understanding between couples, and may He grant us the right guidance when it comes to guiding our family. Wa akhiru da'wa ya alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.